it's always good to be around people who know how to praise, because then that means they know the Lord. Dead they're alive, for the dead cannot praise them. And they that know the Lord, hallelujah, will continually rejoice and praise and a shout and a thanksgiving. And it's with the praise, and it's with the shout, and it's with the thanksgiving, and it's with the adoring of Him, eager to grow, and things become much deeper for you in your relationship with the Lord. Things that were hidden away now become very apparent. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There's nothing like knowing Him. There's nothing like the beautiful grace that has been given, where Christ Jesus becomes a real and a living person standing in front of us. We get to touch Him with our hands, and our eyes get to behold Him. Hallelujah. Father, just looking for a people whom He can reveal Himself to, that's all. And you've got to understand that the things around you in this world are distractions. They try to run interference against that revelation, try to run interference against that communion. And it's our desire to teach you and instruct you in the ways of God, so Satan's craft can't work against you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. His mercy is here to forgive us. His mercy is here to strengthen us and help us. His mercy is here to keep us even when we don't know how to be kept. Father lays hold on you and He won't let go. He's a good God. And there's no reason for you to feel anything but happy and full of thanksgiving concerning how he loves you. Hallelujah. He was wounded for my transgressions, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. Wow. I just pray in the name of Jesus that every one of you will be able to taste that, touch it, feel it, become a living reality to you. More so than it is now. You may be more captivated by what God has done for us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I want you to be seated, because I want to spend some time. You have very beautiful boots. I'm gonna spend some time tonight just working with you by the Holy Ghost and by the Word of God, so that you'll be just so caught away in the things of the Spirit. See, the Spirit of the Lord's has come to be able to supply to us all those things that Father created us to have. And, you know, once again, the Lord's not interested in all the stuff that we supposedly want to bring to Him of ourselves. He's not interested in the songs and the preaching. He's interested in you flowing in the Holy Ghost that is going to take you someplace, going to take you beyond yourself, beyond the limitations of all the things that you feel and all the things that you know. I mean, for some people, Sunday night church is the worst because they're tired. God, the Holy Ghost, will take you beyond tired. He'll take you where tired is no longer relevant. There's just things that would try to hinder us, stop us. There's things that would try to work in our lives that somehow create so much discouragement we don't know how to go on. But there is a place. There is a place in fellowship and relationship with Him that once you touch this realm and once you touch this place, you can go there anytime you want. And we pray that you'll go there all the time, and especially at this time. Hallelujah. You know, when the meetings start like they started tonight, you want to understand that there's something very unique happening in your midst when that's going on. And If you don't know how to get in, if you do not know how to participate with that, if that's not relevant to you, the best thing you can do is just really begin to go into a prayer and a cry out to the Lord, I want this to become real to me. I want this to become relevant to me. Because what's going to happen is it's going to take you to that place I just described. You're going to find a realm in God that, I mean, I'm telling you right now, Satan has no ability to even match it in any way, to touch it. It's a place of safety and glory. It's a place of revelation. It's a place of participation. It's a place of that great outflowing. The Lord made us interacting with Him so simple. He described it like this. Take a drink. You can't get any more simple. You can't talk or preach or minister a concept on any more simple terms than drinking. That's how difficult it is to get into this realm. And furthermore, the Holy Spirit has come to show us how to drink. Drinking 101, open mouth, take liquid, tilt towards mouth. I mean, it's just really, he swallow now. And he's so long-suffering, he's so patient, he's so merciful. And what we've got to come to understand are the things that we allow the enemy of our soul to do in our lives. We give him permission that will keep us from being able to flow in the Holy Ghost. And the things that Satan would come out against us with to try to impose upon us that we have authority to stand against. Hallelujah. I mean, you know, when you think about it in these terms, when you think about Paul saying, be strong in the strength of the Lord and His power of His might, that's a whole lot of ability. And then even in that context, in dealing with spiritual wickedness, he says, having done all to stand, stand. Because in other words, yes, you are now in this glory, in this dimension of great authority. Now you're going to have to be up against the most rebellious force of hell that has purposed to wipe God from the face of the universe. Now, I'm not going to talk about or minister tonight on the things that we ministered on this morning. But if you weren't here, you want to definitely listen to the YouTube. I'm going to just say this. I just, not in a self-serving way. But Janine was telling me this morning, and it's all God, has nothing to do with me. So, bottom line, she said, it's amazing, you know. I'll ask God a question, you'll answer it. Well, what if she wasn't here? She asked God a question, but she wasn't here to hear the answer. Are you listening to me? And I found that over and over again. I've watched where people have been drifting or they've been uncertain or they've had problems or they have issues, and then it causes them to miss out on the meeting. They've never valued the meeting. They never saw what the meeting, the context of the church, was what. They never saw it to what God made it to be. It's just a religious thing. It's, you know, a familiar thing. We're going to talk about some stuff I could read at home. No, we're not. We're going to talk about and do some things that I could do anywhere else. No, we're not. This is a church. He baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. He put His supernatural gifts and divine powers and ability in here. You know, and we don't have to try to be anything. We don't have to try to do anything. We're just being. We just be. We just are what we are. We just flow in the Holy Ghost. We don't have to try to think, oh, I need to get a word for somebody or I need to have a special revelation. No, we over here just touching heaven, being touched by heaven. God laid a hold on us so we could lay a hold on Him. Hallelujah. Praise God. And He's not saying, let me go. He's saying, cleave. Amen. Lay hold on this eternal life. Woohoo. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm going to talk to you about the goodness of God and what Father's doing, but I've got to backtrack and I've got to tell you some. I've got to try to set things up for you a little bit in the perspective of what the powers of darkness have attempted to do and are attempting to do and how forceful they are with their will. Now listen, when Adam opened up the door and allowed Satan to come in through his transgression, of course we know as the events unfolded, that Eve was deceived by the powers of darkness. She wasn't staying close enough to her husband in this thing. And And then Adam wasn't staying enough, close enough to the Father in this thing. And Satan taught man how to sin. Satan came to teach men how to transgress God. Because really, Satan's agenda is this: to move man and all creation so far away from God that God don't even exist anymore. He's not even relevant. Now, you can actually see that happen. In 1,556 years, really less than 1,556 years, from Adam to the day of the flood, it was 1,556 years approximately. He was able to take that man, those men that were shaped in the image and the likeness of God, and so pollute them and so pervert them and so lead them into the depths of iniquity that they became so everything unlike God that every thought and imagination of their heart was only wicked continually. They became so other than God, so unlike God, that he said, I had to repent for even the idea. He had to repent that he made men. That devil has gone nowhere. That devil is on you. He's on you. And he don't care how he's got to do it. He just looks for different people's flavors. Some people's flavor is religion. Some people's flavor is lust. Some people's flavor is strife and war and greed and all these different things. He doesn't care, because all he's got to get is a little bit, and he can work to the very depths of your being with that and pollute you and twist you and make you everything different from God. Ultimately, what we see then, if we then jump, we went from the beginning, if we jump all the way to the end, and we see a conclusion where Satan goes. When we're talking about the things and the events that we are now engaged on, and the entire world is moving to this great apostasy, where they want to be nothing like God, where they do not want to retain the knowledge of God in their realms of thinking. This is where it's all going. To the place where Satan is able to gather together all the men of the earth. He's able to gather together all of his demonic host and come up against God with everything that he can muster in heaven and in earth to try to overthrow God and break off his bands and break off of his authority and his power over his creation. Now, you might not be able to imagine, it's no fairy tale, it's no mythical story. This is the living reality of what you are engaged in, and it's known as the Antichrist spirit. It's known as the anti-God power, same thing. Father wants to show us how we can take a hold of the glory that he's given and be in a place of safety and shelter, where everything that Satan would try to do against us and everything that he would try to impose upon us is ineffective, to the point that no weapon formed against us would be able to prosper, to the point where we have authority in every dimension to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, so that nothing can any by any means hurt us or touch us. So whether we can walk over in this realm of union with him, abiding and dwelling in him, to where that we don't sin and the wicked one cannot access us. God, in his wonderful mercy and love, came to redeem man in the midst of this pollution, in the midst of this wickedness. Satan has fought. Satan fought against it with everything he had before Jesus got here. Then he fought with everything that he had against Christ Jesus, God manifested in the flesh, when he got here. And now, after that, it's all finished and he can't do anything about it. His focus and his rage is set against his church. Father has put up a boundary and a barrier and says to him, he said, by his divine power and authority, the gates of hell cannot prevail against his church. The union that goes on between the church upon the earth right now, I know about church like this, where the leader, where the pastor and those that are around him in leadership are set on the ways of God. There is a means by which we are in league with Father that literally everything about the person of Jesus is present here. Everything about the person of Jesus in his authority, in his matchless power, over all principalities and powers and might and dominion is resident here. Where the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, which is a great protection and a great defense, is here. And it's for each and every individual to understand how to take hold of. But the reality of it is we don't understand the tide of the Antichrist spirit. We don't understand the power of his deception and of his craft. Many people cannot even begin to relate to the manifest presence of God that is right here. And if you could be walking in religion like a Pharisee and would think that it's a devil instead of God. That's how ultimately Satan's deception will make the presence of the glory of God so unrecognizable. Angels of darkness, angels and devils with their demon spirits have taught man in every way all the wickedness that they know so that man will become everything unlike God and everything like them. And the agenda isn't for them to become everything like them. The agenda is for them to become everything unlike God so that God becomes foreign, so foreign that there is no connectivity. All around us, people, this wickedness is increasing. I know that what's going to happen towards the last days, because I read Revelation chapter 9, that there will be a rise again of idolatry and the worshiping of demons and sorcery and all kinds of wickedness, because the Lord highlights that and says they won't repent of these things. I know that the mother of harlots, the queen of heaven, that rebellious stronghold that is manifested right now in many dimensions, but one particular dimension of feminism, that manifestation of that power that ultimately will be destroyed in the middle of the tribulation, simply so that Antichrist can be the only God worshipped, who will himself, as it were, slander and curse and rail against the Most High God with the greatest threats a blasphemy. It makes Nimrod look like he was a junior. And he's fashioned after the likeness of Junior, after the likeness of Nimrod. Because both of them are serving their same master, Satan. All they're doing is expressing what's in the satanic realm's heart. Somebody said, why are you telling me this? Because I want you to go to war. I want you to understand that the great deception, another earmark of the last days, one of the great deceptions, is that the church is going to give themselves over to doctrines of devils and seducing spirits. The church is going to become a place where men love pleasure more than they love God. And see, the enemy of our soul doesn't care to start with how much he can get of us. He just wants something. Because with a little something, with just a little bit of disobedience, he can work within you, your imaginations being wicked continually, in so much that God repents that you exist. Just a little sin of disobedience was all it took. Adam's sin disobedience resulted in that state. People think there's going to be some big event. No, all Satan wants to do is involve you more in the world. He is the one who created the structure of the world. He's the one who created the sociology that you're a part of. He's the one who created the system that you bow to if you're not careful. He's the one who created all the things in the realms of pleasure that men get involved in. That if you're not careful, it's going to compromise you. And the more things that you allow yourself to be involved in that the satanic realm is doing, the less you can hear from heaven. the less you can receive from God, because it's distraction, it's running interference. And I can go through a list. I went through some things this morning. I'm not going to do that this evening. But I can begin to show you, and I can begin to point out to you, and this is a big part of what the discerning of spirits is all about, what's hovering over your head. And it's only hovering over your head because somehow you took an offense. Somehow you've got a problem. Somehow you've allowed this thing to continually operate on you, work in your thinking. Somehow you gave your members to it, and it's coming on you big time, saying, no, you have to serve me. You have to do these things. They've got a strategy. Their purpose is to make you everything unlike God, so unlike God, that you move so far away from God, that all creation moves so far away from God, God doesn't even exist anymore. That's what Satan was saying when he stood there bragging in the day that God had one champion, Job. God's always had one man. You know, when you think about that it's going to be as it was in the days of Noah, there's billions of people on the face of the earth. God's got eight people. Really, he's got one guy. And he commands his house. And he's separated. The Lord looks across the time and says, will there be any faith when the Son of Man comes? I mean, I look at a lot of people in Judaism, and they're just as much wrong and just as much far, just as far away from God as anyone else is. And they got moral standards and they read the Bible, but they're on their way to an eternity without God, because they've allowed an iniquity to deceive and work against them to keep them from recognizing the only means of deliverance from the stronghold of Satan. Am I making a point that Satan doesn't matter how much of you he gets? He just wants some of you. He'll do the rest later. He'll do the rest later. But what I see within the Christian community is I see the restraint against sin and iniquity, as it were, being removed, which is a wild concept because that's supposed to work the other way around. And it's really all a part of the deception. It's all a part of taking us into a great falling away and a great apostasy, where the love of many wax cold, because iniquity is everywhere. The mother of harlots who participated in the demonic realm, we call her the mother of harlots because that's just the way it's all laid out. The demonic realm set this thing up. She's not only manifesting herself in feminism, but the force of pornography, it fits her. That's who she is. She made her worshipers, you know, you can read the old ancient Greek historian, she made her worshipers, didn't matter how virtuous you were or pure you were, you had to at some time in your life come and worship her by prostituting yourself, at least for one event. If you were pretty, it went pretty good for you. If you were ugly, it went really bad. Because once you sat in her temple, you could not leave until the events were done. If you're ugly, you could be there 3, 4, 5, 10 years, who knows? No, and that's what they did. And all the things that Satan did and all that was going on in that realm of iniquity, and I'm talking about after the flood, was to create within men the worst kind, to lead men unknowingly into the worst kind of illicit immorality and display of unbridled lust. I see it everywhere. And all the babies had to be sacrificed to the devil. We've already had over 62 million babies sacrificed to the devil, to the unbridled lust. It's all going on, it just expressed in different ways. Somebody said, oh, that's a coincidence. It's not a coincidence. The demonic power is just alive and kicking with his rebellious design against God as he's ever been. And the church is asleep. And the church doesn't recognize the tricks of the enemy. They're ignorant to his devices. I want you to go ahead, begin to understand that you engaged in a battle. This battle right now is about you. It's about your soul. And if you begin to get sober, begin to become vigilant, knowing that your adversary goes about seeking to destroy you and to devour you, suddenly you're going to step up and you're going to recognize God's made a way of escape, and you better take heed unto it. You better get rid of all your choices that you got, all your options, all your integration with the world that you've normalized and justified, because that's just how deception works. You better take a hold of the Word of God and the Spirit of God in an uncompromising way and understand what God did with His grace when He came and brought His holiness upon our life and set us apart unto Himself, which is this thing that we call sanctification, being set apart unto His holiness, to now be taught of God, to be kept by His power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To have a shield of faith that quenches every fiery dart of the wicked one. That if you just give attendance to what God the Holy Ghost is doing, you'll just listen to Him and walk with Him and say, cut the stuff off, shut the stuff out of your life that you've allowed, that you know are compromises. Begin to just enjoy this holy communion with Father. And give yourself to the beauty of His ways that you and I were shaped in His image and likeness to have anyways. He said, you won't even stumble. The church has turned their back on that. They've embraced all kinds of lies. I've been listening to some of these things. I asked different people to go sort out for me templates of things for children's ministry. I read them for about 2 minutes. I go, goodness gracious. You need to write your own. You use the template. Use the template, but put the doctrine of the Word, the doctrines of God, of Christ Jesus in it. And then the deception that goes. I was like, you know, Leslie sent me some. Said, here, look at this one. And the deception that is in it. And it's such intense trickery deception. And trying to teach children that sin is any thought or behavior that displeases God. That is such lies. Such lies. Most people can't even discern it. They don't know the Word of God enough. Some of you in here are still scratching your head going, what's wrong with that? Just to muddle who works. To run interference with reality. Of what sin really is. And just in case some of you are still scratching your head, I'll stop for a minute before I move on. The thought of sin is not sin. Praise God. Otherwise, Jesus would have been a sinner. Because you can't be tempted with sin and not have a thought of sin. Are you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Okay. And now you're going to sit down and teach kids something that's totally erroneous. That's just what Satan does. He distracts you. He distracts you from the way of God, the Word of God. He don't care what he's got to use. False doctrine, subtle lies, whatever. Sin, iniquity, self-interest. Probably the biggest, number one thing that Satan uses against God's people, which is probably only second to condemnation, is a spirit of offense. Somebody said something to me, they hurt me, they insulted me, and you don't even have proof most of the time. You know what I'm saying? If you've sued them in the court of law, it'd be thrown out by the lawyers. You know what I'm saying? It wouldn't even make court. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. They look at you and go, what? You know what? Are you listening to me? Yeah. Jesus, help us. We're going to have to understand who our adversary is. We're going to have to understand what's going on, lest we're swept away in the apostasy, lest we're swept away in the seducing spirits, lest we are the people also that become those who will not endure sound doctrine. You being corrected is sound doctrine. You know how much that rebellious spirit works on people's life. I can't believe he corrected me. That's not love. It is love to correct. Next time you correct your child, you just tell them, I'm going to correct you because I don't love you. Because that's what I believe. You know, there's no logic to deception and to the lies that Satan runs. I think the most important thing that God's people are going to have to step into and grab a hold of for themselves is the faith that's been delivered to us. the beauty of our privilege to now come and dwell in Christ Jesus. He invites us. He says, this is the anointing which Satan is Satan's chief enemy. He fights against the anointing. He fortifies everything, just like the giants came in and fortified, and all the armies of the giants came in and fortified the land of Israel so that when God brought them out of Egypt, they would not be able to inhabit the inheritance that God gave for them. So all God's inheritance, Satan comes out with the same kind of opposition against you. And you're going to have to know how to take, not sword and shield, but the word of faith. And by the Spirit, begin to effectively deal with them. And I mean, I can go on and on in the scripture, type after type after type, on this issue of where Satan comes out to stop the anointing. He comes out to resist the anointing. He wants to eliminate anything of the presence of God and the word of God and the purpose of God from being effective at all. We know if our gospel is hid, it's hid from them whom the God of this world has blinded so that they cannot see. It's about time you and I step over into the realms of glory where we have such a glorious light that it shines through the darkness. It pierces every part of it. Hallelujah. That even if you're blind, you can see now. It's so bright. And that's really some of the things that the Lord's laid on my heart to talk to you about tonight. But I want to talk to you about it in terms of the things that the Spirit of the Lord ministered this morning so that you understand the value of what God has done and the value of what God has given to us through the blood of Jesus Christ that's washed us and cleansed us. Through this wonderful new birth where now we have been invited to come and dwell in Him, and where the anointing that we received from Him is a divine supernatural resident power that is teaching us to continually dwell in Him. And there we find ourselves now with great power and authority, because now that we're willing to dwell in Him, according to 1 John 2:26 and 27, now we come to recognize He dwells in us. 1 John 4:4. And you have overcome them because greater is He that is on the inside of you than he, the Antichrist spirit, the power of the anti-God working of the satanic realm that took humanity in less than 1,556 years and made them so twisted and so unlike God so that their imaginations were only evil continually. They did not have 1 second of a good thought, 1 second of a holy and a right thought. Everything was wicked. Is it work against you? He was somehow think that Satan died. No. There is a restraint upon him. Praise God. What Christ Jesus did 2,000 years ago put a great restraint upon him. His Father now pleads with the nations. He pleads with the peoples of the earth, inviting them to come. But as men reject this invitation from God, Satan is allowed to move in with a greater force and claim upon their soul. Listen to me. As the people, even God's people, as they somehow begin to drift away and they're not willing to go all the way with God, Satan has given them permission by the will of man and the decision of men to come and work a greater stronghold in their lives. We talk about demonic depression, and we talk about demonic oppression, and we talk about demonic possession, and those are certain consequences of that. We talk about things that are going on in people's lives that are afflicting them physically, afflicting them spiritually, and afflicting them financially. I'm talking about Satan being able to legislate that much more of his rebellious and defiant acts against God to come and claim your soul and to claim your life. In some dimension, to stand up against you and say, no, your blessing can't come upon them. Or to come against you, instead of coming against God, to come against you more effectively and say, no, you have no right to receive the blessings of God. You can't have this inheritance. You can't live in it. Open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 4. and verse 5. Hallelujah. Takaramon jishikaya. Limanda say in the pile. Lakianamon chiprana. Hishiprana saya. You know, the enemy come along, try to use things against you and say, ha, see, I place something on you where your throat's all messed up, you can hardly talk. My reaction is, you ain't done nothing to me. All this doing is resulting in me having that much more authority and power to bust you everywhere I find you. And when you walk with God, you turn everything against the devil. And you just let him know, no, I'm coming at you by the strength of the Lord and by the power of his might. And what happens is somebody gets touched by the anointing of the Holy Ghost, just like David. And they become so full of the zeal of the Lord. You're not just going to back down, back up for anything. In fact, you're going to back down or back up for anything at all. All of a sudden, who Father is and what he said and those things that he's established becomes more important to you than your own life. Hallelujah. It's a beautiful privilege to be able to dwell in Christ Jesus because there's no condemnation there, you see. He said the anointing teaches us everything, hallelujah, that we need to know. And he teaches us to dwell in Christ Jesus. And, of course, the Word teaches us to dwell. Jesus says, come on, dwell in me. Oh, what great blessings there are dwelling in Christ Jesus. What benefits there are just in dwelling in him. Hallelujah. And then when you turn the thing, in the reciprocation of it all, and he's dwelling in us, there's nothing bad that even has a chance. But, you know, really what Satan does is he works condemnation to wiggle his way in. He works, he works shame and guilt, try to take a hold of folks. And some people get spiraled down into condemnation quicker than anything. Just get yourself overdwelling in Jesus. Just remember what the Word says, I know I'm in him, and we coming after you, you foul spirit of hell. They try to claim my, members of my family. Come on, people. Come on. I mean, you're going to have to recognize what it is that you're doing right now with all that God has given you to turn the battle around. How you are effectively coming up against Satan instead of just making it consequences and circumstance and happenstance and whatever stance. You listening to me? You have to get yourself in it. You're going to have to get yourself in reality. You're going to have to quit being detached from reality. And I described this morning a person on the battlefield walking around like they're at Disneyland. You know that person's nothing but a fit for the straitjacket. Somebody tackle him and put him in the cell that he belongs, padded cell that he belongs in. Too many people are that detached from reality. Too many people have never really had much of a revelation of the reality of Jesus. I am set on you obeying and cooperating with God enough to have a greater manifestation of the person of Christ Jesus in your life so that you can begin to get a hold on reality and quit normalizing everything and making it all about your issues and all about coincidence. And start recognizing what you're up against. Are you looking? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sutarastane pikeya. Hallelujah. Boranatani. Let me just use this. Botakaranaya suparanaya. Hallelujah. Kiristaturomukina. Hallelujah. Sutarashambotekane. Verse 4 says, when the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, that happened for you. Yes. Is there anybody in this place tonight, you're not sure whether or not the sin and the iniquity of the filth that has been placed upon your life because of your walk with demonic powers, because of the hold of Satan upon your life, has been washed away. Every person was born in sin. Every person born in sin and shaped in iniquity. The loveliest baby, the one that Jason and Casey just had. Micaiah, is that his name? He's going to have to get born again. His life is going to have to be changed by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Praise God for the prayers of the parents, because the prayers of his parents make him clean, bring him into a place of being acceptable unto God. And there is a provision of God's grace there within the framework of that kind of leadership, spiritual leadership. But there's going to come a day he needs to be washed from his sins, and he needs to be born again. There comes a day, and we're living in that day, where the Lord will wash away the filth of the daughters of Zion, and shall have purged the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of judgment and by the spirit of burnings. And look at what the Lord's going to create. The Lord is going to create upon every dwelling place. And I want you to say, dwelling place. And I want you to recognize that there's a particular word that is used here in the Hebrew language that it always refers to a place that God inhabits. This is the place that the Lord inhabits. Woo! Hallelujah. And I hope tonight that that isn't aloof from you or far away. I know that as soon as you begin to have that wonderful communion with the Holy Ghost about the fact that you're the habitation of God, I don't care how sedate you are, you're going to get jolted by the glory of heaven and begin to become very excited about the things of this so great a salvation. I can just see a few people standing around the throne of God like they stand at church. And my lips sinking, that's their singing. It ain't gonna happen. Why don't you look at where you're going, okay? See where you're at and recognize the change that needs to take place. You can understand me?
Yes.
Instead of trying to just say, they're picking on me. Yeah, we're picking on you, man, because we're tired of having to deal with your ugliness. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? We're tired of having to hang out with you, man. You wet blanket at the party. You know what I'm saying? Huh? You're raining on our parade. You know what I'm saying? Hello. And I'm talking about religion. I'm not necessarily talking about anybody in here. If a shoe fits, go ahead and put it on. But, you know, get yourself a new pair soon. In Jesus' name. God's going to create. God's created something for us on every one of his dwelling places. Whew. Think about this. I'm the dwelling place of the living God. That's going to change everything. Somebody said, well, I don't think you're the dwelling place of the living God. You got a sore throat. Well, I don't really have a sore throat, but just my voice is tweaked. I don't know. I guess I oversang a little bit on Wednesday night. Sang a little bit harder this morning. I mean, what I try to do is just if there is something going on like that, I mean, I just let it rip. You know what I'm saying? We're not holding anything back. We're not reserving anything for later. We're giving all we got now. Amen. No. You look at the wrong things. You better be careful. You'll let Satan point out for you the wrong kinds of evidence. He'd start creating lies and deception that would try to give you another identity. And so it's, well, if God's dwelling in you, you wouldn't be whatever at any time. God's dwelling in me, and I got a bit of a weird throat right now. Hallelujah. And Almighty God's walking on the inside of me, and no angel is going to tell me different. Neither should some little sore whatever throat. It's not sore. But some weird whatever is going on, my voice comes to an end. In Jesus' name. I want to help you. I want you to start living by the Word of God and the Spirit of God. I want you to stop living by all this other, you know. It's not even anecdotal evidence. It's imaginations. at least anecdotal evidence. Somebody did something somewhere and it looked like that or this. It seemed to be, it appeared to be. There was something that happened that made you think it was true. So much of the stuff isn't even happening to people, just imaginations. Imaginations. People, come on now. If you would just live in one simple thing, to you, you're the dwelling place of God Almighty. Amen. Listen, you're not going to overcome the wicked one. You're not going to be able to deal with the Antichrist spirit unless the greater one lives on the inside of you. Because it's not going to be by who you are and by what you can do, but it's by the power of God that is at work on the inside of you that is not going to be at work unless you acknowledge, that you observe and acknowledge and agree with and praise God about. Because otherwise it's faithless. It matters nothing. It's going to have no impact. Just the thing about God's word. It has to have faith. It has to have agreement to work. It just has to have agreement. It's about time that you start, you know, bringing yourself into a place of continual voluntary agreement with God. It'll work out so much better for you. Scripture says that he will create upon every dwelling place in Mount Zion, that is his community. It's not a geographical location only, because we there right now. I'll take you over there, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 22, and prove it to you. He's created upon Mount Zion and upon Mount Zion's assembly, hallelujah, a cloud of his glory. Now, I want you to just begin. I'll just refinish reading this. A cloud and a smoke by day, and a shining and a flaming fire by night upon all the glory for a defense. Now, I want you to think about that. I want you to think about the supernatural glory of heaven that God has created when he poured out the wonderful, beautiful means by which we've been born of the Spirit and then baptized in the Holy Ghost. This is a realm that you and I get to live in. But if we're not willing to participate with this realm, we're going to be vulnerable to everything that Satan is throwing at us, or at least most things, or it's going to be cyclic in our lives. And one week we're good, and the next week we're bad. You know, 2 weeks we're flowing in the Holy Ghost, and 2 weeks we're out for the count. And you never know what the body of Christ is going to look like at the next meeting. Because somehow we failed to realize that there is a continual flow of the power of God made available to us, a continual outworking of the Spirit of the living God in our life if we'll allow ourselves to just agree with them and participate with them. God has created something here. You know, and when you think about, let me just kind of just describe it like this. If you look at it in Exodus chapter 13. Go look at that cloud in Exodus chapter 13, because we know that Isaiah is using this terminology. And he's talking about, it's almost like in the context of Isaiah, he's talking about something that almost just goes beyond just the glory and the habitation of Father dwelling and hovering over top of his people and being a defense for his people and being a protection for his people, a power that we're kept by through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. He's created something. Wonder what that is. Scratch the head. If you know what he's created, just raise your hand. Come on, people, it's not a trick question. And maybe you don't even know who Isaiah is talking about. He's talking about you. He's talking about everybody that comes into the covenant. Wonder what God's created. that's different than what Israel had when the cloud of glory was over them. Take a wild guess. Anybody know what I'm talking about now? I'm talking about the new man. I'm talking about the new creation. Are you just kidding? You're just playing with me. You just don't want to raise your hands. Is that it? Tell me that's right. That's what it is. We're not participating tonight. It's almost like he's created something. Well, maybe that's just really where we're at. We're like, well, it's almost like he's created something. He was willing to dwell in the midst of Israel. But now he's come and made our lives his habitation. He's made our lives this glorious realm that somehow the value of it and the purpose of it hasn't really hit us yet, because the social structure, the sociology, the system, the politics, the financial structure that we live in right now demands us to be something else the majority of the day, every day. And we're just all bowing down. Work. I owe. And we all look around each other going, work, I owe. And we think, well, we're doing the right thing. I owe. I'm going to owe some more after Christmas. People, this stuff ain't going to work for much longer. God's people are going to have to learn to do community. I'm telling you right now. You cannot see it. The writing's on the wall. Turn this up if you don't mind a little bit. You can't see it. The writing's on the wall. We're seeing society. We're seeing the structure system of humanity quickly eroding to look more and more like what it was in the days of Noah. We live it right now in a time where people are beginning to manifest more of the satanic hatred against the anointing, the presence of God. And more of a satanic hatred is now being manifested against anything about the name of Jesus. It's about time people start saying more than Merry Christmas. They try to shut out Merry Christmas. I'm Merry Christmas and everybody I see. If you got a skull cap on, you look like a Muslim. Merry Christmas. If you got a yarmulke on, you look like a Jew. Merry Christmas. I mean, I'm telling you, this gag order has got to stop, and then it needs to elevate to praise God for the Jesus Fest. Joyous Jesus Fest to you. Somebody go, what is that? Oh, that's the same as Merry Christmas in layman's terms. I'm tired of speaking Latin. You know what I'm saying? He's all running around, all stoked about speaking Latin to one another. You know, Merry Christmas is Joyous Jesus Fest. Hallelujah. People talking about Christ. There are many Christ. Huh? Just go over into Hinduism. You'll hear Christ all the time. Christ here, Christ there, Lord that, Lord this. Huh? People just are happy going, Christ, Lord, devil don't mind that either. You pull Jesus out, he's like. Yeah. First thing he's backing up, especially if it's the name of Jesus, is authority in your life. The next thing he's doing is looking, can he shut that down? And he's going to come at you. He's going to try to shut it down. You got to know who you are in Jesus Christ. You got to recognize what's afoot. You got to recognize the strategy, the satanic ploy that is against your life, and take a stand in this wonderful and glorious liberty whereby Christ Jesus has set you free. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is the reason for the season and all seasons. Amen. Praise God. And that's beautiful.
I get the Jesus in there.
Hey man, you do. I know, baby. I know. I'm kidding. I was actually going to have you preach tonight. The only reason I didn't I have to have her preach on a night that my throat's not bothering me because I'm not backing down that no stink of nothing. It looked too much like I tuck tail and run. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I'm not doing that stuff. Huh? Backing down because of some circumstance. Come on, man. It's just time. Anytime it looks like some hindrance is time, you just take it up another notch, man. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If your leg's bothering you, go for a run. I'm not kidding you, man. I've lived this realm of breakthrough. Hallelujah. Sikotarama setiat. Bondari shikana mohuyapraya. Dendele. I live in divine health. And to talk about living in divine health and love the beauty of living in divine health. And the enemy comes out and says, oh yeah, I'm going to put something on you. I'm going to show you you're not Mr. Divine Health. Huh? Because he's rebellious. He's defiant. Everything of God's beauty and everything of God's splendor and everything of God's blessing, he's doing everything that God will allow him. God will not allow us to be tempted above what we're able. But everything that God will allow, he comes in there and he comes at us. But what I know is I rejoiced on my tribulation because all I'm not bowing to his lies. I'm gonna get stronger out of it. And you better start trembling right now, man, because I'm coming at you as soon as this is done. In fact, I'm coming at you right now in the midst of it. Amen. You have less authority, you have less power, you have less opportunity when this is over. Amen. Because why? The grace of God's going to see me in that place of the strength of the Lord and the power of his might, standing and having done all to stand. I don't budge. Amen. In fact, it's literally advancing. It's moving forward. The standing isn't just, you know, standing as it were still. It's just that you could only inch forward just a little bit. But there's always the advancing going on. Can you see me? Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the anointing. Father, we thank you for the anointing. Now, Satan is opposed to that. The powers of darkness is opposed to that. It is being more manifested in men every day. They're opposed to that. Where this thing is going is we will be hated by all nations for his name's sake. I'm going to tell you right now, the harlot, the mother of whores, huh? The queen of heaven, she's drunk on the blood of saints in the tribulation. She's also going to rise up in a kingdom that will exist before the tribulation, and she's going to be drinking again. For the first 200 years of the church history, she was a part of the destruction of hundreds of thousands of Christians. She drank a lot of blood. She drank a lot of blood in 1,400 years of religious power being levied against the church. Hello. She didn't go anywhere. She didn't go anywhere. Now we see her rebellion and her defiance more manifested in the ranks of the people of God than at any time ever before. In the Western world. And by the way, most of her manifestation and most of her power and exploits within the realm of the demonic is a part of the Western world and Western civilization. Hello, did you know that you're the descendants of the Greeks? Did you know that? Maybe you didn't know that. You're descendants of the Romans. You're descendants. The Western civilization descends all the way back from Egypt. Did you know that? And finds its high point, one of its high points in the Greek world. How much of that are you allowing to affix to your life? How Greekized are you? How much did the work of Alexander the Great impact you in the way that you think and the way that you act and the way that you process and the way that you live your life versus the kingdom of God and the Holy Ghost? I'm going to tell you right now, an angel came up out of the bottomless pit. Look, there's angels, there's fallen angels all over the place, but this particular angel is so ruthless. He's so evil. He's such a tyrant that he has to be contained in the bottomless pit until Father allows him to come out. He allowed him to come out. during the days of Alexander the Great, so that this thing could be advanced to the stage that it's ultimately going to come to, where Father's going to create a new heaven and a new earth, and those things will, the former things will be passed away, and they will never be remembered again. I'm going someplace beautiful, and so are you, whether you know it or not. I'm going over into a glory land where everything that Satan has ever done with his angels and his demons and his imps and all the people that want to follow him won't even, not will it not exist anymore. It won't even be remembered. It won't even come into mind. You think about it. How Greekized are you? Or how kingdomized are you? Because the kingdom shows a very different kind of lifestyle and commitment and behavior and interaction. God is not a capitalist. Hello. He set up his laws so capitalism could not even exist. I know you think it came down from heaven. God made sure that everybody returned their stuff after 50 years. You can use it for 50 years and you give it back. You listen to me. He kept a leveling field. Hallelujah. There was certainly an opportunity of free enterprise and freedom to, you know, become prosperous, but not at the expense of oppressing others. And I'm not going to go in to the vices of capitalism, because the vices of socialism are worst. Huh? And the vices of any government, all of them are various different structures created by Satan to ultimately elicit his will in various different dimensions and degrees, and to set all men at odds against each other. But I'm not talking about which one I like. I'm telling you about the kingdom of God. That's the one I'm liking. I'm over here in the kingdom. I'm just pointing out to you. You're not going to find God hanging out with Alexander the Great. A demon spirit was ruling over him. That same demon spirit is going to be released from the bottomless pit again. And he's going to do his evil work again. I mean, I think when you think about that, when you think about what Alexander the Great did, he did out of a direct league with such an evil angel that he has to be bound in the bottomless pit. And then you got to recognize, wait a minute, how much of what that did that evil demonic angel teach Alexander the Great that I'm living in right now? And wondering why the flow of the anointing isn't greater. Wondering why the manifestation of the power of God isn't greater. Wondering why these things that Father has made available to me just seems to be aloof. Yeah, I'm talking about you and I pressing in. I'm talking about us contending for a faith that was once delivered unto the saints. I'm talking about us being conformed to the image of Jesus and no longer conformed to the world, because that was designed, it's infected, it's filled with every demonic power, with every demonic imagination, for a purpose: to eliminate God from your life, to move you so far away from God, to move all creation so far away from God that he doesn't even exist anymore. Think about that. I'm gonna get up in these fighting shoes right now and do some kicks. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, when the adrenaline gets to flowing, my feet can go really high. It's quite amazing. I can bring every part of my body, knees and elbows, to bear. I'm telling you. Hallelujah. Man, I've got a hard head. I can do some damage with my head. Woo, that's a big fist coming at you. You know what I'm saying? I'm putting everything to bear, so to speak. But knowing that, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty, but that doesn't eliminate us with everything within us bringing it to bear. Because that's what it takes. It's not sitting around playing patty cake baker, wasn't it? No little child games. Come on, man. We're talking about a fight. We're talking about a battle against the powers of darkness that we have been privileged to have the insight to know what's going on, that we can go set people free. God has made us deliverers in Zion. Amen. He's made us deliverers in the deliverer himself. He's made us those who can go with his saving knowledge and saving power, with his word, and break off the stronghold of Satan. And the beauty of the heavenly vision is to get a vision to know and realize, as the Apostle Paul did, that you and I have the power to turn people from Satan. As long as Satan is able to play his games on you, you won't be able to ever realize the power. You have to realize the power by revelation of obedience with God before it will ever be effective in your life. You listen to me. It just sounds like a story. But you begin to walk with God, and you begin to obey God, and you begin to get serious about this fellowship and this relationship, and you begin to do the things that he tells you to do, and you stop allowing the things that belong to a demonic realm to influence your emotions, and suddenly you're going to begin to recognize the reality of Satan. You're going to begin to recognize your authority in Christ Jesus to deal with him, and everything changes then. And I'm looking for that everything to change right here tonight. So I'm looking for some more change tonight. Amen. It's going to result a revelation of Jesus, a revelation of the reality of what he's called us to, of his grace that has been provided for us so Satan can't touch us or access us, the seal that is upon me by the Holy Ghost so Satan can't come claim me. It's so wonderful. It's so beautiful. I want to know it. It's so huge. It's so glorious. I want to be able to show it in a greater dimension. This should be your heart too. And it's also that same anointing is teaching us to have no integration with the demon spirits around us and with things they do. What is fundamentally the thing that demon spirits do? Sin. That's why John said he that sins is of the devil. That's what they did. They taught Adam from the beginning how to sin through disobedience. Then they showed men. They came and interacted intimately with men. It was a very different world that 1,556 years. Remember, God put the cherubim angels to guard the way of the tree of life so that Adam wouldn't come back and eat. Adam lived for 930 years, right? It was about 667 years, something like that, or less. More years until the flood. He almost lived to the flood. And then when you look at the depictions and you look at the stories that are told that were handed down from Ham. Hello, these guys were looking at cherubims. These guys were looking at angels. Men didn't get to the iniquity that they got to in 1,556 years on their own, hanging out with God. They got there because of the interacting with demon spirits, with the forces of angelic power that came to defy God and to lead men into iniquity. They're still here. They're here right now. You and I are at war against them. Paul said, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Take into yourself the whole armor of God, because you're right now wrestling hand-to-hand combat with spiritual wickedness in high places. That's a reality. Did Jesus destroy their authority? Yeah, he did. But that doesn't mean that we're not in a battle, because everything that God describes to us in the New Testament clearly describes us being in a battle, engaged in a war. Hallelujah. We are warring a good warfare. I hope it's a good one. Hallelujah. We are fighting the good fight of faith. I hope you're fighting. Amen. Paul by himself basically took the one they called, that those people of the area that he was in called Diana Artemis, which is the queen of heaven, which is the same as Astarte, Esther, Ostar, Easter, lots of names for her, Asherah, Astra. Here's how wicked she is. Jezebel was one of her high priestess. Jezebel come marry Ahab. Jezebel's a high priestess of Ishtar, Ashtart, Asherah, whatever you want to call her. It's all the same names. And she's the prostitute whore for Baal, or Bel, who's also associated with the rebellion of Nimrod. Let's think about this. So she says, okay, here's what I'm going to do. We're going to make Yahweh the consort of Ashtart. And she's going to become Almighty God's whore in Israel. No, there's depictions of this. This is stories. I'm not making up something. Unfortunately, this is what she did. This is the abomination. These acts, these things, This is why God destroyed the northern kingdom of Israel. You might as well hear it. This is what happened with Judah. This is why Judah was taken into captivity. This is where wickedness goes. And she shall rule over him by sexual immorality. She will produce a great sexual need in Almighty God. And that's what she taught Israel. People, I want you to understand the sexual immorality that is on the rise. And that spirit, it isn't going away. It's all an indication and description of who she is. You listen to me. What does the Lord Jesus say about the Jezebel spirit in the context of his churches in Revelation chapter 2? She seduced my servants. Is that going on? There are so many of God's people, some that were great champions, taken out by that thing. And now it has a way of coming in its power through the World Wide Web in a way that has never been seen before. But it's going to get a whole lot worse. And your children will be a prey if you don't know, if you don't learn how to start walking in the realms of the kingdom of God, if you don't learn how to start doing things different, if you don't learn how to start flowing in the Holy Ghost, if you don't learn how to start abiding in this that God created in this new creation, if you don't start living in this place that he's given to us as a defense, his glory. It's not something that is just passive. You hear me? God's, the glory that Father has given us, it's not something that is going to passively be in our lives no matter what we're doing. It's a submission of the Lord. It's a response of obedience, of hunger and thirst. It says, I desire to be continually filled with the Spirit. People want to come and stand in a prayer line, and they want somebody with an anointing at a period of time, lay hands on them, and then they can feel good and smile and laugh for the first time all week. You might have had a couple of giggles here or there. With that kind of realm, with that kind of spiritual life, Satan's going to invade you right, left, and center. You have no defense. There is no glory. You're caught away in the frustration of living out your everyday life. Work, I-ho. Work, I-ho. Can't go to church, too tired. Can't read the word, I'm worn out. Work, I-ho. You look around, everybody else is doing it, you think, oh, well. This must be serving God. Oh, oh, oh. The more you interact with that realm, the less you're able to interact with the Spirit of the Lord. Not because God wants it that way. You chose it. Satan is the enemy of the anointing. You can't give him any place. Listen, praise God, it's not by our own strength and it's not by our own power, but it's by the Spirit of the Lord. But we're going to have to understand how to start living by the Spirit of the Lord, walking in his glory, walking in his mantle, understanding that his impact upon our life is greater than all the other physical needs and all the other issues that come to bear in our life. Jesus said, you're going to get this straight. You better get this straight. Don't give any concern about food and clothes. Don't do it. It's going to mess you up. It's going to make you vulnerable. Gentiles go after that stuff. It ain't going to work out for you. It's going to compromise you. Here's what you do. Shove all that stuff aside and come after the kingdom, because you're going to have to learn how the kingdom, you're going to have to learn how the kingdom works. I gave my kingdom to Israel. They wouldn't walk in it. I've taken it from them. And I'm going to give it to another nation that will bring forth the fruits thereof. That's you and me. Are we bringing forth the fruits thereof? Or are we being compromised and assimilated by something that an angel from the bottomless pit taught Alexander the Great that lives till today? And ultimately grows into a place of greater and greater ruin until second phase comes. And that same angel comes out of the bottomless pit beginning the first part of the tribulation. Middle part of the tribulation. I want you to get into a battle. I want you to get into a battle. I want you to make sin for what it is. It's an angelic power of darkness. It's devils from hell releasing demon spirits to ultimately bring men to a place that they're so far from God in their attempts and hopes that ultimately God could be overthrown. And in the meantime, there's all kinds of casualties because literally hundreds of millions of people are dying every day and opening up their eyes in a place of torment, a place absent from the glory of God. God is not willing that anyone perish. He's not willing that anyone perish. He wants everyone to come to the knowledge of salvation. He said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. That's what he said. He said, the grace of God has appeared to all men, not just some men, everybody, teaching us, run for your life, get separated, live righteously and godly, deny ungodliness and lust, and live over here in this realm of holiness. Amen. We don't hear the urgency of it. We hear, the grace of God brings salvation appeared to all men, teaching us to deny worldly lust. Deny ungodliness, worldly lust, and the righteousness, soberly godly in this present world. And we just go right on past it. No, it's an urgent cry. You're at risk. Oh, Ristana Meshekuta Nestapaya. Mainandos de Bredeshi Akaya. Hira Sonayapan. What the Lord did when He made a new creation and He gave us a new heart and a new spirit, and thus making us the temple of the living God for the Holy Ghost to come and dwell on the inside of us, making us His holy habitation, where He has become our God, we are His people, and He's on our side and our defense. And then baptized us in the Holy Ghost in fire is far greater than what we read about right here in Exodus chapter 13. I told you to turn there, didn't I? Yes. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud. That's what we just read in Isaiah 4:5. He led them by the way by night in the pillar of fire. In other words, it's His accompanying presence. You think about this, people. Too many of us are willing to let the majesty of His accompanying presence in our lives go almost unnoticed. We've got to stop this mess. We got to stop this mess. We got to throw on the brakes here. We got to learn how to walk with God. We're going to have to learn how to live in the Spirit, walk in the Spirit. We're going to have to learn how to be thankful for what God has done. Some people still aren't really maybe aware that they've been delivered from the power of sin and death, that they've been delivered from an eternity without God. I mean, start there, then begin to think about, wait a minute, I'm not only been delivered, but God's holy habitation. And begin to get excited about it and begin to allow God to work revelation in your life. He wants to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. That means now you have the ability to see what's really going on. You're not detached from reality anymore. All this other stuff that you're doing where you live out your life for yourself, running to and fro, is a clear detachment from reality. It's to have been assimilated in the flow of humanity that is running in a structure designed by the deceiver who's deceived the whole world. And as He's allowed, He can take whatever's going on right now and everybody that's participating in it, and He can turn it for worse. And everybody that's in it and participating in it right now and going with it, they'll go right with them. They'll have no power to resist it. And then He'll take it to that dimension for a while, and then He'll move it right on into even a greater dimension of wickedness. Okay, you with me? Some of you are looking at me like, I don't really think that's true. Well, I don't really understand that. Okay. Let's take silent movies, 1920. I'll just take one example. Let's take silent movies, 1920. The church rose up and said, it is an iniquity. It's born right out of hell. It's literally the vomit of devils. Go and look at it. We'll sit there and go, that's so innocent. Why? Because it has become so corrupt as what it is right now. The demonic power of it is so much so that God's people are going to have to detach themselves from all the association of it. We basically just done it. We just, because we, you know, once again, it just comes to a place where Father says, no, it's gotten so bad. No, you can't even be, don't go anywhere near it. Don't touch it. Don't have any association with it. It could be a snare unto you. There are things that God told Israel, drive them out. Don't sit around and think about it. Get rid of it. Destroy it. Most of that was because the people were so corrupt already by their integration with fallen angels in the land of Canaan that they were so given over to wickedness and to the worship of these devils that there was no redemption. There was no hope for them. God said, cut it off. They didn't drive it out. They didn't cut it off. What did it become to them? A snare. Was it a little snare? It's kind of tough, you know, but we're making it, you know. I'm kind of bummed. We just didn't do what God said, but praise God, we're still making it. No, it wasn't that kind of snare. It was the kind of snare that ultimately brought their total ruin and destruction. You listen to me. Satan could turn it. Everybody that is in that thing, he was able to take it from 1920 to 1940. Go back and look at 1940 movies. I mean, they're like, once again, it's innocent compared to what we're living in. Because it all becomes relative. Wickedness becomes relative. Go over into the holies of holies. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to abhor yourself. You listen to me. You need to spend some time in the holies of holies. Because you're going to go, you mean I've been allowing that and that and that and that and that and that, and I've had this attitude and that attitude. You mean I've had these kinds of desires or these kinds of wants. And maybe they all are just earthly and natural. But they become so apparently wrong and such a distraction and such an ultimate snare to just to ruin. You can't see it in relativism. Looking and comparing yourself among your people, yourself among the culture that you're now living in. You have to come over here in this place of interaction with Father. Amen. You ask our Father, call him Father up and ask him what his opinion is instead of everybody else. People are agreeing with so many things that literally have such demonic strongholds in it, and they're unaware. They don't know. They're unaware. They're unaware. And then somebody comes along that is aware and begins to tell them. They're looking at him like, are you serious? Could it really be that intense? Yes, it is. You know, there's this other verse of scripture that goes along with this in it's Exodus 14:19. In here, the Lord shows how his glory is a protection. Praise God, in his mercy and his grace, he came and he was to Israel something that they could have never asked for, they could have never prayed for. There was a man living in Mesopotamia, in the city of Ur, the birthplace for all, every religion came from there. Every religion was born there. Hinduism, Buddhism was born from Hinduism. The Brahmanism that came from that region. I could go on in all the various different daughters of Brahmanism, the daughters of Hinduism, the daughters of Buddhism, the daughters, I mean, it's on and on, of Islam. I came from that region. God found a man there, Abraham. He said, Abraham, I want you out of this land of adultery. Abraham wanted deliverance. He had a heart towards God. He said, I'm out of here. You don't even need to tell me where we're going. I'm leaving now. I've heard your voice. I want out of this. We've got to understand, people, his voice is calling us out. He's saying, come out from among them, touch not the unclean, and I will receive you. But we're so compromised. We've already got these other commitments. We've already got these other ideas and visions of our life. Praise God that you heard when he called you out of darkness, that you wanted to be delivered from sin. Praise God for that. That's excuse me, That's a giant step by itself. Now let's go on with God. We were born of the Spirit to walk in the Spirit. We were delivered out of hell, hallelujah, to no longer be conformed to this world, now to be shaped every day by God, the Holy Ghost, and learn how to live our lives in the realms of the Holy Ghost. To learn how to live our lives in faith, in confidence, in boldness, in love, in peace, in virtue, in godliness, in brotherly kindness. Come on. All these wonderful things that if you just give yourself to them, you won't even fall. No, forgive me. You won't even stumble. What a protection. I mean, the beauty of the shield of faith. The defense of his armor, the whole armor of God that we have simply by being filled with the Spirit. Because when Paul says, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might, he's talking about being filled with the Spirit. He just got finished talking about in Ephesians chapter 5, to not be foolish but be wise, knowing what the will of the Lord is. Not to be drunk with wine where it is in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah. Speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and giving thanks unto the Lord. He brings that ultimately to the place of the outworking of the strength of the Lord and the power of his might in the midst of us, which we then find ourselves, just because we're living in that kind of fellowship, we're living in that kind of glory, we're living in this kind of benefit. And it's not that hard. It's as easy as drinking. It's as easy as just obeying God and making his word what it's supposed to be in our life and giving ourselves to just talking with him and interacting with him and submitting ourselves and at least just start off recognizing him. There's many things we've told people to do. I've told people to do for years that they still don't do, and they wonder why they can't move forward. I've told people for years, when you get in the car and you're driving to church, start praying in the Holy Ghost. There's people still don't do that. And just like Naaman, never going to the Jordan. And he'll still have his leprosy. It's just like the man who was blind, who got spit in the mud in his eye, and never went to the pool of Siloam. He's just walking around with mud in his eye, wondering why he didn't get healed. Well, Jesus, he spit, made mud, put it in my eyes, but I'm not healed. Well, I wonder why he's not healed. Did he tell you anything else? Well, let me think. Yeah, he did say something about pool of Siloam, but I was really busy. We've been having some tough situations going on at home, so we weren't able to make it. Well, I'll tell you right now, that's why you still got mud in your eye and didn't get healed, because you didn't obey God. Dear people, listen to me. Is that what you're going to teach your to do? You have to recognize, is that what you're going to teach her to do in the meeting? You have to recognize. You have to recognize that what you're doing, what's going on in your lives, you've got to recognize it. It's having impacts upon you and those that are around you. You've got to recognize it. How do we get a hold of ourselves? It's a difficult thing. How do we submit ourselves to the Holy Ghost? That's not too difficult. God's given us the pattern. He's described to us how to do it, how to walk in these things. Come on now. But what happens? Why do we delay? Why don't we implement them? We're busy. We had other things we had to do. Oh, I just didn't remember. I believe that there's some interference going on when you can't remember after 20 years of hearing it over and over again, because you're just not that dumb. You know what I'm saying? Right? So I'm not talking about any person. I'm just creating a scenario of where people, so that you may see how that Satan is able to stop what God has for you, freely given. You never stepped into it. You're missing something. But if you just recognize, first of all, there in Exodus 14, he shows to us how that the cloud by day, the fire by night was a defense. It was darkness to the Egyptians. It was light to the Israelites, so that neither of them could come anywhere near each other. And so they were protected the whole time until God says, take the protection off, scare them a little bit. That's basically it. God could have kept it that way. You know with me? And they could have just walked over the Red Sea. No, he said, take the thing down. Here they're coming at you. What are you going to do? Well, God, we're going to trust in you because we know who you are. Nobody said that. Nobody said that. Moses said that. Maybe Joshua said that. Everybody else was like, ah! Stone Moses, look at what he's got us to do. He's a terrible leader. He's going to look at this. We're trapped. Well, that was cool. Nice thing about this throat thing, you got all these kinds of weird squeakies coming out. God says by his servant Zechariah, chapter 2, verse 5, he says, For I, says the Lord, will be unto her, speaking of Zion, speaking of his people, a wall of fire round about, and I will be the glory in the midst of her. Understand, this is me, is how I'm living up here. Andokeah. And I am pressing in to be be a greater beneficiary of this blessing, of this glory that God has created over me, this protection that he's given. Now, you say, my goodness, just think about it. Wait a minute. Am I living in that kind of a manifest presence of God in my life? Well, it's available. Whether or not you're participating with it might actually be addressed by Psalms 91, verse 1. He that dwells in the secret place. God has showed and opened up our eyes to the realm of the secret place. He's invited us into the secret place. He said it like this. He said, come dwell in me. It's like, oh, I just love to find the secret place. We went over to the prayer meeting over there. Not the secret place wasn't there. Then we went to the prayer meeting over here, and the secret place wasn't there. Then I went into my closet, and the secret place wasn't in there. Then I went in my living room, and the secret place wasn't there. Then I went out into the tree house, and the secret place wasn't there. Then I went out into the desert, and the secret place wasn't there. Then I found myself a good spot up on the top of the mountain. I thought for sure that'd be the secret place. But I was just distracted the whole time with the beauty. It was in the secret place. The Lord Jesus says, come dwell in me. Come dwell in me. That is an active response of our heart and our life to him. That is something the Holy Spirit himself comes and shows us how to do because we participate with him. Because you wake up in the morning and you're not going, work, and that's all you're thinking about. Because many of you are going to run the risk of doing that in the morning, as you've done time and time again. And you better be careful, because if you're in the flow of those things that Satan is able to control, manipulate, when God allows him, he'll take you into deeper perversion of what God's purpose for your life. He'll take you in deeper deception, a deeper distraction, a deeper disappointment, a deeper discouragement, a deeper unforgiveness, a deeper resentment, a deeper compromise. There is nothing that Satan does in people's lives that are fixed by some natural circumstance or by some human management. People think, especially concerning the proper desires that are created within men, those sexual desires that, oh, when I get married, it's all going to be fixed. I'm going to be fixed. That's what marriage is about. There's something important in that, in marriage. Ain't nothing going to be fixed. Because the demon power is going to be just that much more. He's going to work that much more destruction with whatever thing that was going on in your life in that dimension over there in that relationship, and you'll destroy more there as well. I want you tonight to hear my heart, hear the cry of the Spirit. It says, listen, you're going to have to understand the people that went before us. They talked about the results of what it meant to get along with God in terms of prayer and being in His Word with respect to the increased manifestation of His power and His glory in His life, their life. Read about Charles Finney. Everybody wants to talk about the Great Awakening in Charles Finney. Read about Charles Finney's life. I mean, the guy didn't... He was like totally out of pocket for him to be in prayer and think less than 4 hours in a day. People want to talk about George Whitefield's life. The guy had camel knees. His knees were spread out. He spent his life on his knees praying. And now they want to have a great awakening without that kind of giving ourselves over to another realm? Listen, it's another realm. We just want to make it all natural and normal and whatever and just going to fit in. God just going to fit into our casual everyday living. Praise God, we'll go to church on Sunday morning. And we live totally detached from reality. Now the Lord wants to train us on our knees. Amen. Train us in the secret place. Amen. He's going to train us in His Word. You're not going to be offline and get trained. It's just all there is to it. You have to just, what do you mean I got to do something? You mean there's some kind of work involved? I mean, I just can't believe these preachers. They don't know how busy we are. Now they're trying to put more stuff on us. Now we got to pray. We got to read our Bible, plus go to church. And they're all upset if we're not at the prayer meeting. They got Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, and sometimes Friday night. No, we need to turn this thing around and understand all the stuff you put on your life that you're saying God needs you to do. He ain't say nothing about that. Somebody said, preacher, you trying to tell us we're not supposed to go to work? What I'm telling you is this. I'm telling you, God's got to be first. You could say that Jesus told you not to go to work. I mean, if you look at His message, it's pretty radical. Yes, it is. Unless when you go to work, you're seeking the kingdom. I can see that about Brittany, going to work seeking the kingdom. Because she's always got on her heart who she's going to bring to church next time, who's the next soul she's going to harvest. Huh? She's not under a gag order. She doesn't go there and go, I can't say nothing about Jesus here. Guess what? You're not going to work. You're not going to the kingdom. You're going into a realm and a stronghold of the enemy. And it's all about you. And you want to quit that job. Quit that job. Come over. Live with me. I'll take care of you. If you don't believe God will take care of you, I'll finance you for the rest of your life. Get you out of that stuff. Anything to save your soul. You hear me? But what happens when work becomes a place now where you're seeking first the kingdom? Where all of a sudden, you're depending on the Lord. Father, I'm getting ready to walk in that workplace, and you know what I've got to deal with. And Lord, I need that glorious manifestation of your love and of your joy and of your power and of your peace to be overwhelming me. Come fill me. Come strengthen me. Lord, use me. That's a different way. I'm going to tell you right now, there are people in this church right now, tonight, that do not do that. If you say you're forgetting, I'm going to tell you that's a demonic stronghold. This is a way of life. Amen. This is a way of life. This is the way we live, man. What are you talking about? I can't remember. That's exactly the realm of deception that I'm referring to. They that dwell in the secret place of the Most High, think about this, this is beautiful, shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. What is the cloud by day? The shadow of the Almighty. What is the fire at night? It's the shadow of the Almighty. The secret place is the place where He alone is and nothing else can be there. It's a protection and defense for you. It's a protection for your children. I'm so blessed you got your children in church. And what a blessing they are. Watching them grow in the things of God and the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Whew. Hallelujah. The world, you listen to me, the world is a formidable foe. Let me have your Bible. I don't think that people have recognized what the world is. I'm sorry I'm having to say this because it's almost like unthinkable. But we would have to go back in the church at least 40 years and really more like 50 years to find the definition of worldliness. Because it's been completely lost. Can you hear me?
Yes.
It's been completely lost. Once again, under that influence of the enemy, it looks pretty harmless right now. The prophets, the people who can see, the people who have a contrast between God and the things of this world are saying that the powers of darkness is in the midst of it. But now He's able to turn it deeper and deeper in deception, where we've just lost any concept of worldliness. The Lord says, all that is in the world, the lust of flesh, lust of the eye, the pride of life, has nothing to do with the Father. He says, if you've got a love for that, you don't have the love of the Father in you. And what's happened is we've normalized it. We've called it harmless. And we've allowed it to be a part of our life. And we've not recognized what it is. And yet, what the Lord does is He sets up for us again and again. He sets up the battle lines at the interface of the world. And so when you look, for example, in 1 John chapter 5, look there with me. I figured I'd just preach until I'm completely healed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Takaramoshikaya. No, I'm really going to preach until you're completely filled. I'm going to say that again. I'm preach till you're completely filled. Till the yoke is off of you. Huh? Till all of a sudden you recognize who you are. You stand up big in the presence of God. You quit diddle-dallying around, start moving on into higher ground. You just quit allowing the Word of God to have no profit in your life. You don't let the grace of God be bestowed upon you in vain. But you've taken those things that God has already given you by His Spirit, and you run in the race with the men. Hey, my goodness, you don't know what happened. I got baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, and I'm telling you right now, I'm running with the program 12 hours. I'm giving myself that abasakia tonight, and we're going to try to move it into my sleep round two. This is an amazing power of God, amazing gift. You're not just taking it for granted. Oh, well, you know, I got baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. And you know, every once in a while when we're in the meeting, I get a little ta-da-da-da. When you don't value that which God has given to you and begin to fully utilize it, then it's bestowed on you in vain. Now, Father, in His mercy and His goodness, He's long-suffering towards us. He gives us time to grow. He's like, the Lord knows we are slow. We're slow-witted. We are, man. We're slow-witted. And And so because he's so, he knows that, he's like, okay, yeah, I know I've been telling them now for 15 years, but I'm going to tell them another day and another year. And hey, you know what? They moved up from 2 minutes to three. I'm blessed. They went from 2 minutes, like a week praying, to 3 minutes now. We're making some progress. Imagine every hour of your life is like a gram weight. And you got a scale in front of you. And for every hour of your life that is spent for you, it's not for the kingdom, it's spent for you, you put it on one side of the scale. And for every hour that you spend in the kingdom of God and the things of God, you put it on the other side of the scale. What does your scale look like? Would the Lord come to you and say, I've come to judge you and to measure you, and you found wanting? I'm not running the risk. Somebody says, sounds like me, you're trying to earn your salvation. I'm not, I'm obeying God. He purchased my salvation so that now I can obey him and participate with him. Huh? They just say that because you want to occupy yourself in the spirit of the world. You just want that interference of me and bring that lie towards me because you're trying to justify your evil and your disobedience. I got your number. Stay right here for just a few more minutes and I'll give you a couple words of knowledge about what you did yesterday and what you were thinking a few minutes ago. Because Father is just that gracious and merciful to bring people out of their lives in deception, especially when they step up with a mouth like the Antichrist. The Lord's not going to, listen to me. The anointing of the Holy Spirit and the release and the manifestation of the anointing of the Holy Spirit is directly associated with your willingness to live a consecrated life. Because they mean the same thing. We want to have a greater anointing without a greater consecration, and they're the same thing, they're wrapped together. It's about time you stop letting all these other influences interfere with the presence of God in your life. It's about time you stop letting all the other voices of the world drown out the still small voice of the Father. It's about time you come out and be separate and recognize, hey, he's better to be with than all the rest of the stuff. I'll take Jesus. Take this whole world, but give me Jesus. Take this whole world, but give me Jesus. I don't know that we really even got that yet. I don't know if that's still in, is that still in the church? It's here, it's in me. What kind of Bible is this, baby? This is like got all kinds of dictionaries and I got to search to find the Bible in here. Turn with me quickly. The First John. Mom's got every kind of Bible you can name. I mean, there's another package arriving. She bought some amazing Bible from eBay that no one wanted anymore. And now what's this one? Well, this one came from, that's good, baby. She is the collector of the Word of God. Amen. And it is beautiful. Just sometimes we get into some of these Bibles and it's like, whoa. First John 5. Hallelujah. 1 John 5, verse 4. You there?
Yes.
For whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. Do you know how to, can you define the world? Do you know how God defined the world? Because he defined the world beyond just the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. He defined it beyond that. Can you define the world? I know what's happening is Satan through his deception, because where he's going to take the church is into a great falling away. He's going to take the church to a place that they listen more to the sound, the voice of darkness than they do to the voice of God. They won't endure sound doctrine. Why? How did the church get that way? Because they integrated with the world. They did not even understand this verse of scripture. They didn't understand the conflict. We're talking about a conflict. These are conflict words here. He that is born of God overcomes the world. That is a conflict. That is a place where you and I are up against something that is opposed to us, that has come to overthrow us. And we conquer it. Have you defined the world? Do you dance to the world's music? Are you entertained by the world's stories? Do you sing the world's songs? Do you delight in the world's pleasures? It's entertainment. The things that it holds value, that it's willing to give its whole life to have, to obtain. It's very important for you to understand this, because the Lord Jesus brings it down like this. And he says, you're not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. And now he's dealing with the entire social structure and things that men desire and delight in doing, including includes within it the framework of religion. And especially everything. I mean, just imagine, if you could just to simplify it, because I could start walking you through, for example, Matthew through Jude, and be outlining for you all the things, pointing to you all the things that are in the world. And really, what it's going to come down to this, it's a huge list, it's going to come down to primarily a large part of the day-to-day events that you behold everybody being involved in around you. And you can picture it like this: Jesus is not the world. And everything that's not Jesus is the world. Heaven is not the world. And everything that's not heaven is the world. The Holy Ghost is not the world. Everything that's not the Holy Ghost is the world. Just that simple. Are you at battle? Are you in a battle against it? Are you at war against it? All of the guys, even Ravenhill, he wasn't that long ago, others, they all prophesied of a time when the church was going into a deception, to where that they wouldn't recognize a difference between worldliness and godliness. And we're there. Because we believe that we can be godly in the midst of worldliness. That's not recognizing the difference. We believe that we can actually be so involved in the world and not come under Holy Ghost conviction about it. What does it mean when the Lord's saying, come out from among them, be ye separate? What is the Lord saying when he said, if you're a friend with the world, it's an act of hostility against me? What is he saying? What is he saying? That this is the faith. That this is the power that has overcome the world. Here in verse 4. He says, he that is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the power or the conquering authority. And if you just, I don't know how your Bible's going to read it, and I want you to be able to track with me. King James says, and this is the victory that overcomes the world. Victory is the overcoming power, overcoming authority that overcomes the world, that defeats it, even our faith. But stop for a second. What is the faith? The faith is to have a new heart and a new spirit, to be born again. That's the faith. The faith is to be in Christ Jesus. That's the faith. What is in the world? The Antichrist spirit. I write unto young men, because you've overcome the world, because the word of God abides in you. You've defeated the world. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The world is the place where the Antichrist spirit works. The world is the place where lasciviousness would try to draw you in, where temptation would try to draw you in, where things that are not pleasing to God will try to get a hold of you and draw you in. It's a place where pleasure, there are pleasures. Men will love be lovers of pleasures more than God. We've got to be careful here because we can be just so caught out in all kinds of pleasures and said, oh, God has freely given us all things to enjoy. Oh, really? You're taking that scripture out of context. That's about taking scripture out of context to the same level as all things are lawful, which is the embodiment of anomia. Because that's not what Paul was saying when he said all things are lawful, but not all things are expedient. He was talking about the food, kosher food, and whether or not you're going to eat food offered to idols. He says it's not expedient to be offering that food, to eat that food that was offered to Artemis. It's not expedient. Now people say all things are lawful and make it as though all sin is okay. That's anomia. That is the embodiment of anomia. That's what the Antichrist is. He's the embodiment of anomia. It means anomia means iniquity, or iniquity literally means lawlessness. I have no laws. I have no restraints. I can do whatever I want. No matter how immoral it is, I can do it. No matter how evil it is, I can do it. That's anomia, no restraint, iniquity, no law. Do you have a law? I'm under the law of Christ Jesus. I'm under the law of God. Hallelujah. I'm under the law of the Spirit of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm under his governorship. I'm not lawless. That's why John said, he that sins transgresses the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. In other words, he says, when you sin, you immediately come back under the judgment of the law. The soul that sins shall die. Go read it. Listen, I'm spending some time with this tonight because you've got to hear it. You've got to listen to me. Whether you're here in this place right now or you're watching by the web or by YouTube, you've got to listen. The Word of God is very clear on these things. We're missing out on all the blessings and all the glory, or at least the most of them, and the benefits, because we're simply not willing to obey God and come out from among them and stop diddle-dallying around with the influences of the demon spirits that would literally shut down the flow of divine power in our lives. One of the beautiful things about fasting and praying, and I really believe that if you're going to fast, you need to give yourself to just praying. It's not fasting and working. And believe me, people, I know I spent so much of my life bivocationally working on a job, and I still do, and ministering. I realize that it can be a challenging thing to be busy. But all of a sudden, if you start taking everything about your life and you turn it to the kingdom, you turn it over to the Master. Mm-hmm. Say, Lord, I'm doing this unto you. I want to be here. I want divine appointments today. Holy Spirit, I'm giving myself over to you to be led by you, to be governed by you, to be taught by you, to be kept by you. Lord, I'm saying to you, Lord, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. I'm looking for the coming of the Lord. Lord, I want everything that you have for me in my life right now, not something later. Your kingdom come, your will be done right now in my life. People, if you'll just make some simple adjustments. You just make some simple adjustments. I'm asking the Lord to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him, to where that you can begin to see the reality of his person, of his presence. Your eyes can be more open to the reality of the things that are going on right now that are a battlement against your soul. But listen, when you obey God, when you don't understand, even if you don't understand it, you just obey God. I don't understand it, but I'm just going to obey God. At the moment of obedience, the act of obedience is going to bring to you revelation and insight. You'll see. You'll see. You're going to be blessed by obeying God. You're going to be blessed by going through your house and making sure that there's nothing unholy in the place, that there's nothing that's going to create lasciviousness, any kind of lust or immorality, any kind of work, any kind of evil in your thinking. Not allow it. People, I had a mass exodus many different times because I called out certain things like the Hunger Games series that people were getting caught up into because it's a demonic realm. The Lord showed me it's a demonic realm in a very unique way. It's a demonic realm that other movies wouldn't create. It creates, just like Dungeons and Dragons, you know, other certain things, they create within, they're strategically able to create within the emotions of people a participation on another demonic level that is less obvious. People left. I told some people, look, you're just going to have to quit listening to the music of the world because I know how it's born. If you said, oh, it's music, it belongs to God, that's not true. Satan has his own music. He's a musician. And there's music that is born out of communion with devil spirit, demon spirits. Moloch had music for himself that brought people under the spell. I could go on and on with all these other idols that we could mention. When Nebuchadnezzar set up his image for everybody to come and bow down to as a type of Antichrist, something the Antichrist will do in the same geographical location, but on a whole nother scale. He had music. He had the harps harping, the flutes fluting, the drums drumming, every type of instrument playing. And at the sound of the music, you were to go with the music and do worship to this image. People go, oh, I can't even believe it. You know, it's just so legalistic. This isn't legalism. This is coming out from among them. It's coming to a place of being separated unto God, simply obeying him, being willing to follow him, being willing to go where he's going, do what he's doing. Give yourself to a communion with the Holy Spirit instead of demon spirits. The Holy Spirit has a different kind of fruit. He's producing hunger for God and awareness of the presence of Jesus, a burden for the lost, a willingness to walk in this beautiful realm called love. And I'm telling you, love is the key to every dimension of a greater manifestation of the power of God in your life. There's a different fruit when you're sitting there listening to all this other stuff and being involved in all this other stuff. Where does it take you? It's not taking you into heaven. It's not taking you into reality with God. It's taking you on a venture. Where does that adventure lead you? What works in your thinking? What works in your memory from that? What works in your emotions? Did you go to bed that night and have a visitation from heaven and ultimately realize the things that God has purposed for your life? Or did you go to bed at night and have to deal with all kinds of weird dreams? I'm going to tell you right now, dreams, listen to me, I know I'm putting the heavy on a lot of you. Dreams reveal a lot of the things that you're interacting with. Dreams reveal the spiritual realm that you're interacting with. You listening to me? Sometimes Satan comes, demon spirits come and try to impose upon us things. The day is all right. She's got to learn. Just wrestle with it. Wrestle it to the ground. Amen. Somebody said to me, well, I would go to church over there at the Abiding Place if they didn't do meetings by the calendar. I mean, on Sunday mornings, many times church service used to go to 3, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So he said, well, we'll come if you don't go that late. So I didn't change. But after a period of time, the Lord said, okay, we'll just back it off. We'll back it off. Just run 12:30, 1 o'clock. None of those people came. What they don't realize is they're going to give an account for that at the day of judgment. Because Papa heard it. People think they're talking to me. They think they're just talking into the air. No, you're talking to Father. You're talking to Dad. Our God, the living God, who's been so gracious and merciful to bring us into this covenant, to bring us into this family. Oh, let's let the spirit of wisdom and revelation give us an understanding so we can start seeing what's really going on. We can start interacting with him in the way that he wants us to interact with him. Yes. I've actually never had this happen to me in my life. This is actually the first time in my life that I've had this happen in my throat. Preaching. This is a new thing for me. I've been in expectation every moment for it to get clear and change. But it matters not to me. I still know the authority I have in God. Amen. I still know what he, nothing about his healing power has changed.
Right.
Nothing about his grace has changed. Nothing about his promises have changed.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because I don't live by circumstance or situations. I live by the word of God, by the spirit of God.
Amen.
And I'm just saying that for you.
Amen. Yes.
Saying that for you tonight. Maybe I need to be this for some of you tonight.
Amen.
So that you can watch how I stand in this situation and then behold the greater anointing, greater glory of my life later.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you.
I mean, because, you know, that's just the way it works. Jesus said that the things that he has to give to us, the world cannot receive them. And the world cannot know them. Does that define the world for you? Are you at war against it? Are you compromising with it? Or even are you embracing it? So I'm just going to close tonight and read that verse. I want to just go read that one verse of scripture. And I know a few minutes ago I got a little distracted with something that was going on. The Lord was showing me. And I misquoted a verse of scripture, so I'll quote it right. I write unto you, men, because you're strong. The word of God dwells in you and you've overcome the wicked one. But I want you to understand, we're talking about the world, we're talking about the wicked one. Because he's the prince and the power of the air. That's the God of this world. What did he say to Jesus? He said, bow down and worship me. And I will give you everything that you see. All the riches, all the honor, all the glory, it all belongs to mine. Everything that you can be, all belongs to me. Everything that you can behold with your eyes that is to be gained and had on this earth is mine. It belongs to me. He defined it as his world. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
I want you to make your stuff belong into the kingdom of God tonight.
Yeah.
I want you to get your house consecrated to the Lord, your car consecrated to the Lord, your pocketbook consecrated to the Lord, your work, your business consecrated to the Lord. The stuff that you have, I want it to get completely out of the realms of the earthly and get it over into the realms of the heavenly. If you're on a job and the Antichrist rules there and you're going to get fired for talking about Jesus, go ahead, talk about Jesus, get fired, and start a business.
Amen.
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 Probably what's going to happen is you're not going to get fired.
No.
Because Satan It's got a whole lot of bark, but just a little bit of bite. You hear me? Let's just change it tonight. What keeps you from telling other people about the things of the kingdom? What keeps you from flowing in that glorious anointing when someone who is bound by the powers of darkness is standing in front of you? Listen to me. Let me tell you what it is. It is the spirit of this world. It's the prince of the power of the air. You should have enough authority to no longer be hindered by him, because you've met his resistance enough to where that you've broken through it. However, if you're still not there, recognize that it's time to step up and start engaging, because the only reason you haven't pushed past it is because you've not dealt with it. You submitted to it. I'm just believing God, praying that we define the world for you tonight, that you can understand that realm of wickedness, that realm called the world, will take all mankind to the battle of Armageddon, even as it took all mankind to the place that it repented God that he made man. You have to be at war against it. The spirit of it. People are becoming more demon possessed. Listen to me. People are becoming, going greater into a greater depth of wickedness. You know, Ruth Ann and I was talking about the siren that's used for Starbucks, and how that the siren is an image of Ashtart, the queen of heaven, and how that people want to just make it like, well, you know, it's not a big deal, because that's like, you know, that's like some fairy tale. It's not a fairy tale. And then they go gather under her banner, as they did in antiquity, and enjoy some kind of pleasure, as they did in antiquity. Oh, it ain't that. Well, you can say that it ain't that. But then when the CEO stands up and says, if you believe that traditional marriage is superior to homosexual marriage, we don't want your business. You just now took it to another level. Because now when you go and you give them your money, you're saying by the leader's declaration, and he put it out there so everybody could know about it and hear it and read it hand over mouth for just a few minutes. And he agreed it. Then every time you're laying down money, you're going, I believe that homosexual marriage is equivalent to traditional marriage. When I told people that, when the CEO said it, I think it was 3 years ago, I would have thought everybody would have followed me. Some people did. Some people were gracious. Philip Smithers said, oh, well, there goes Starbucks. I'm not doing Starbucks because you're not doing it. Others said, you're not taking my Starbucks from the man. No way. Don't go there. Preachers. It's like you do whatever you want.
So I just cancel that right now in the name of Jesus.
You can try to cancel that in the name of Jesus if you want. But it doesn't change the CEO's declaration. The siren, the picture of that has to start. Come on, give me a break. So I said, well, if we were not to participate with everything that is involved with iniquity, we wouldn't have anything. Would you define anything for me, please? Apple computer. Apple computer was designed, the apple with a bite out of it. That's the Garden of Eden. It's a good thing. It's Milton's Paradise Lost. It's an act. It's an act of defiance against God. We love Max.
I don't.
Don't go there. You know, think about it. Where does the compromise end? Somebody said, well, Whole Foods supports unplanned parenthood. Unplanned no parenthood. I mean, you know, he says Satan's subtlety, planned parenthood. You lying, stinking liar. That sounds good. You just talking about you, we gonna abort your kid. Why don't they say place to kill your kid? Satan ain't come at you that way. He's not gonna come at you that way. He's not gonna come at you that way. Let me tell you something, what I'm gonna do to you. I'm gonna tell you what I'm gonna do to you. Papa's gonna grab a hold of you. I'm gonna tell you right now. A few minutes, I'm gonna start treating you. Know, it ain't funny. A few minutes, I'm gonna start treating you like I did your dad. Things are gonna go from giggle, giggle, happy, happy, where I'm the big attention sideshow, to I'm in some serious hot water because she's doing wrong and doesn't know it. She's deceived. She's misinterpreting what's going on around here right now. Like we do so often. I just wanted to find the world for you. I want you to understand. I want you to listen. You listen to me. It will not be long. It will not be long. Hand over mouth, some kind of discipline, something. It will not be long. I will not, I refuse to be a offline, no comment grandfather. I refuse it.
Amen. Thank you.
Huh? Because Miss Wheel's got to be submitted because it ain't even close. Are you with me? See, she's the reality's turning. She's stepping. I did it to him, and he doesn't have any brain damage. Besides that, he's the dad, and he do whatever he wants. Are you listening to me? It's just the truth. I'm sorry, guys, that you're having to go through the pain and the suffering of us trying to get this spirit under control. Father, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus. Do you do a little bit of this at home? You do? It just... Okay, well, let's fix this. Let's fix this right now. Listen. You're going to have to take her out. It's completely out of control. But you know what? Let me just tell you right now. I want you to listen to me. I want you to listen to me. That is a manifestation of something that goes on in our house. Okay? So they're my children, and so I can say this for your sake. That is a manifestation of something that goes on in the house. And it has to do with authority in the house. It does. I'm going to tell you right now, I can sort this out. I want you to understand, when things are going on in your life, that are out of order, there are telltale signs about what you're doing, not about some other explanation. I just want to help you. I want to help you at my expense, and Joshua now is expense a little bit. Anybody else, I wouldn't be able to do that. They wouldn't come back to church anymore because they're all offended. Because what happened is we just pointed out you have a wart on your nose, and we were supposed to act like we didn't notice. Sorry. We could help you with that, though, because if we pointed out and couldn't help you with it, couldn't get that thing off of you, then that would be mean. That would be wrong. But if we say that word on your nose that we're all supposed to be acting like we can't see, I'll pull that thing off of you right now if you just listen to me. lots of things start happening when you spend a lot of time around the Word.
Amen.
Things that happen in your own house, you spend time around the Word. Just to have the Word out. Things just start manifesting. Attitudes manifest. Dispositions manifest. Wrong behavior. Things. Listen, we can justify all kinds of stuff in our lives. Why do that? Because ultimately, if we do, it is going to run ruin somewhere. It's going to create upheaval somewhere. We don't want anything that the enemy could use in our lives to destroy us having any place in our life. We want it out. I want to understand how to correct this. Instead of self-justifying and going to some little book or going to some little counselor who's going to tell you it's all normal and okay, when in reality it was a spiritual issue that could have been easily fixed. Would you start going to the Word of God?
Yes.
Hey, could you? What'd you think about it? Do you know who wrote child behavior manuals? A demon spirit. Do you know who authored psychology? An angel from hell. An angel from hell. You listening to me? There's no answers there. It's a snare there. It looks like it worked. It's all smoke and mirrors. It's a trick to bring you into a greater stronghold to where now you're living under a demonic word. You're living under a demonic instruction. Why don't you start going to the Bible? Why don't you start praying things through? Obeying God, and watch what will happen. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to read one more verse of scripture. Turn with me quickly, but not so quickly. When you think about God creating His glory for a defense. You're talking about being immersed in His presence. Being immersed in His presence has fruit, has attributes, has impact, has a fact. It's love, it's joy, it's peace. It's a flow. Huh? It's joy divine. It's all the things. All these things. It's like you take John chapter 17. You take John chapter 17 and you begin to look at, actually, I'm not going to go there right now, but you begin to look at all that the Lord has created and established for our life, and He's called us to come and live in that. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Fathers, the order of your house is upon your shoulders. Mothers, your submission to that authority is on your shoulders. Either one of those out of place ain't gonna work. If my wife would have said to me and started constantly giving me information and counsel about what I was doing, my daughters would have been raised to treat me the same way. You listen to me? They would have been coming at me and telling me exactly what Ann's comments were and her concerns and her instructions, to where that they would have had no respect for me at this age that they are right now. Their mom never did it. There was just that, there was that biblical divine order that resulted in something that God said would happen if we obeyed Him. It's proven at every point. You're gonna have to be willing to conform to God and quit conforming to the world. Listen to His word, stop listening to everybody else's word. Do it His way, not your way. Everything about our life. I got some good news for you tonight. You ready?
Yes.
Everything about your life needs to change.
Amen.
Everything. I guess really the good news is that Father's here to make that happen. That's the good news. John chapter 14, verse 17. Hushapahati.
Libroganosia. Libronagashikaya. Verse 17 says, the Lord Father said, I will pray. And he said, I will pray to the Father, and the Father will give you the Holy Ghost. He calls him Comforter. And he will abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. Do you understand the world? It's every dimension of everything that is not in cooperation and submission to the Holy Ghost. And just as I said with Jesus, just as I said with heaven, we could go through these things, and what's like scriptures pointed out to you. No fellowship with the people. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but reprove them. Amen. Say, that's wrong. It's an eternity without God. It's a mocking what God. You're going to just get strong. You're going to have to get bold. Well, I just want to be nice and gracious and loving. That isn't being nice and gracious and loving. That's being willing to let people spend an eternity in a place called hell. You rebuke it. Hallelujah. You're going to have authority against it. Hallelujah. I'm trying my best to close, but I've not been able to. So, even the Spirit of truth in the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him. But you know him, and he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Let a little while and the world sees me. Yet a little while and the world sees me no more. But you see me. Because I live, you shall live. At that day, you shall know that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. This communion, at that day, you shall know, forgive me, that I am in the Father and that you are in me and that I am in you. The Lord Jesus calling us, come abide, dwell in him. The anointing, that's what this is all about. The anointing is teaching us, come abide in him, come dwell in him. The result of that is that nothing of the world is a part of your life, not participating with it, but rather walking over here in this fellowship that it produces for us a defense. It's a glory. It's a provision. It's an abundant life. It's a protection against all deception and every lie. Everything that's of the enemy, all the powers of darkness and everything that they're doing can't touch anything that you've got when you're willing to walk with God, when you're willing to obey him. Stand with me. Jesus. Now I'm in expectation for every single person in this place to get healed tonight. I am in expectation. If you've been prayed for a number of times and haven't been healed, tonight healing is going to happen. I watched over and over again how things work like this. The enemy tries to come out threatening to shut things down just because that, you know, he's trying to interfere with the things that Father's purposed to do. And when you don't let anything about your life change, anything about what God said change, no matter what happens, you're going to find a greater display of God's blessing, God's glory. I know there are several people in here tonight. You're dealing with disease states. You've been dealing with disease states. And I say in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that those disease states cease. Catherine, come here. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Your thyroid right now in Jesus' name begins to work properly. Right now. Your thyroid works properly. Right now. In Jesus' name. Botake na Jose. now in the name of Jesus Christ. This inflammation of your pituitary healed. This thing's broken tonight, in Jesus' name. Who else in here you've dealt with a disease state? You're back. Jesus. Father, I thank you for the creative miracle right now. To create new tissue. Brand new tissue right now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name, this old knot dissolves. There it goes. That is beautiful. That big knot that was sticking right out there, it just disappeared. It's gone. Look back there. Feel back there. There's just a little inflammation, but that knot that was over there is gone. Does it feel different to you? Feels different to me. Lord Jesus, thank you for this miracle right now. I tell you, this back healing job is a done deal. What disease? The strep?
The MRSA, yeah.
In Jesus' name. I command this bacteria to go out of your body. Out in Jesus' name. What's wrong? Just in your hands. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command this pain go out of your joints. This arthritis goes out of your joints. Now, what? Crash.
And then I've been having high cholesterol for a long time.
Where's the lump? I can't feel it. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command this lump to dissolve now. 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 Jesus. Jesus' name. This body, this blood comes in order. High cholesterol in the name of Jesus. Ceases to exist. Now in Jesus' name, by the power that is in the name of Jesus Christ, these lungs open up. This demonic attack against the breath of life ceases to exist. Just breathe in real deep. No more in Jesus' name. Not another day of lung problem in Jesus' name. Not another day. What's up? You heal. You'll be healed. In Jesus' name. healing. We thank you, Lord, that your healing flows like a river. What is it that you need? Blood sugar. Diabetes. Speak to diabetes now in Jesus' name. Foul disease, you leave this body. Leave this body right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Listen, people, every one of you, you can be a part of creative miracles just because you're hooking up with faith. You're just hooking up with it. You're standing here in expectation of what God's doing. What's up?
I've been having a really bad fever morning.
Is it still there? You think just a little? What's wrong?
I think it came up pretty
much.
I think it came up prematurely. I think my problems are just my diet and my lifestyle, actually. Come up here.
It's the truth. Be blessed. Now in Jesus' name, I command you to be healed from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. The power of God flows to you right now in Jesus' name. What's up?
I've had this happen to me for a long time. It's one of God.
In Jesus' name, it dries up. It dries up. It dries up. What's up?
I have an infection in my lungs that's never quite gone away, just a mucus.
In the name of Jesus, out! These lungs from this day forward work perfectly normal. No infection in these lungs in Jesus' name. What's up? What's show me what you got, what's up?
And I still like you. It's all over you.
What is this?
I don't know.
What you said, what did you say?
I don't know. Today I lost my voice.
You lost your voice. I didn't lose mine. I got mine. You need to have yours back. Come here. No, I'm praying for you. That's an I'm not falling down stance right there. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command this infection to leave off your skin, this irritation, whatever it is that's caused these sores, goes from you in Jesus' name. And dries up. What's up, dear?
I have like asthma. great healing in my shoulders.
Okay. Okay, well, we're going to get that. Listen, the Lord loves to heal his people. Healing is the children's bread. The Lord don't want his people in pain and sickness and suffering. That's a big part of what the church is for. He put gifts of healing, working a miracle and gifts of healing in church so nobody would be sick. And if you got sick, you get healed. Asthma is from hell. It attacks the breath of life. And I command it, go out of your body right now in the name of Jesus. Now lift your hands towards heaven. Let those shoulders be healed. That rotator cuff right now. In the name of Jesus now. In the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for a creative miracle that produces brand new tissue in this rotator cuff. I command this pain go out of this shoulder now. And it begin to work properly. Begin to loosen up.
Thank you,
Jesus. Hallelujah. What's up? Are you okay? Healthy baby on the way. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, look at me. You'll never be tormented with fear anymore. That's what anxiety is. I break the power of it. It's a harassing, tormenting, evil spirit. And in Jesus' name, it goes from you and no longer harasses you or torments you. Now, receive. And now, just receive. Thank you, Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let the Lord touch you. He wants to fill you up. He wants to fill you with the glory of his presence in a greater way than you've known. So just go ahead and receive right now. Father, I thank you for the glory of heaven coming upon this life. He is the happiest little baby I think I've ever seen in my life. What an amazing gift from the Lord. What an amazing gift from the Lord. You should never have another bad moment in your life. All you'd have to do is look at him. He's got those little hands, man. They're so small, you wonder how they can even are coordinate enough to find each other. You know, he's got this clap going on. Just joy and energy. What an amazing little guy. You just be healed in Jesus' name. Gain weight, drink milk, eat meat, cake, pies, anything, batten up. In Jesus' name, I command it so. I command it so. The worry and all the rest of the stuff that's been going on that has nothing to do with the things of the kingdom. God has given you a peace and wants you to walk in a peace that the world cannot interfere with, can't take away. So now it's time. Don't let the world interfere anymore. Amen. What do you need, dear? Huh? You have a knee problem. Sports injury?
Yeah.
What's wrong with it?
It's a mentioned issue. And so it comes up time to time. So it depends on how much I do sports.
Well, the Lord Jesus, will you believe the Lord Jesus would heal the pinched meniscus right now? That don't sound very difficult to me. I mean, like if it was a torn meniscus, maybe that be a little bit harder, but a pinched one. Or if it was like a broken kneecap, that'd be a little hard, but a pinched one. I know, I'm just kidding you. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Yachi, I command this pinched meniscus be no more pinched. Be no more pinched. Lord, we thank you for a creative miracle right now. Jesus' name. Arubushiketi, arumoshiana mabate. Hallelujah. 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 What's up?
The baby has some kind of flu.
What's wrong?
Flu. Like a flu.
Oh, she has a flu. Well, that is just not acceptable. And I can tell that she's the boss. She's got that look in her eye. How are you doing tonight, sweet darling? In the name of Jesus Christ, she's going to heal you right now. That old flu dries up from out of your body now in Jesus' name. Out! Goes. What's up? What do you have? To transfer to them. Healed. 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 It's a cure. It's the cure. What's up, Mom?
Open visitation, and I saw the feet of Jesus. And it's time that we bow low, that we get down really low in the secret place with Him. That we've called Jesus our brother, but we've forsaken and forgotten that He is our master, the master over every area of our lives, that He is the general first in command. To bow low, to bow really low in the presence of God and find a place of prayer where the moment you hit your knees, all of heaven is opened and God's ear is inclined close to us. He's preparing an army and He's preparing us on our knees. He's training you on your knees. We're in the final hour. We're coming. coming into a transition where his army at a moment's calling will be arisen and the Son will be glorified in their lives. Have you been preparing? Have you been being trained? It's time to bow really low in the secret place. It's time to bow really low in the secret place.
Yes, Lord.
It will cost you your distractions. It will cost you your time. It's time to bow low because a season is coming. And you must be trained and prepared. It's time to bow low.
Jesus. Lord Jesus. Did you want prayer? Jesus. Are you just, you're clearing out the way. Heaven's glory now upon these women of God. In Jesus' name. A greater display of your power and your authority, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, thank you for your signs and for your wonders and for your miracles. Thank you for the display of your healing power in our midst. Thank you, Lord, that all your promises of God are ours. That all that you've supplied in heaven, you've not retained. Father, I thank you that every single person standing in this building tonight will begin to enjoy, like never before, your presence, this freedom of liberation that you've given to us when you came and delivered us out of the hand of our enemy. That we may serve you all the days of our life and walk in your glory, which is our defense and our protection. And know, God, that you supply all that we have need of according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father. If there's anyone in here tonight, if you're uncertain that you're right with God, if you're uncertain about where you stand with him, tonight, Father wants to give to you a certainty that will last your whole life and throughout eternity. If you do not know whether or not you've been born again and will stand before the Lord on that day, hearing him say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," the Lord doesn't want you to leave this place tonight without knowing. He wants you to know that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And if you don't know that, he wants to do a work tonight at this moment in time so that you can certainly be with everything that is within you. Know that it's true. Tonight, Father has purposed that everybody in this place, that everybody that's looking by web, that everybody that's watching by YouTube, have a fellowship with him that is uninterrupted and that is the full display of everything that Christ Jesus showed us when he walked out on this earth 2,000 years ago, displayed what it meant to have the fullness of God dwelling inside of him. If you're uncertain about where you stand with God, if you're uncertain as to whether or not the power of God has come upon you and created a new creation in your life, if you're uncertain of whether or not Jesus Christ has come to live and abide and dwell on the inside of you, if you're uncertain as to whether or not the Holy Ghost has come to live and abide on the inside of you, God wants you to be certain tonight. The miracle happens in a moment, an instant, in the twinkling of an eye, with a simple acceptance of you calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, saying, I don't want to live in a world of sin anymore. I don't want to live in a world of lust and being under the power of those things that are contrary to God. I want freedom. I want deliverance. I want God to come invade my life. He'll come and everything will change, all by the asking, all by simply calling on the greatest name that has ever been given, the greatest name that has ever been spoken, the name in which God has vested all power and authority, the name of Jesus. If you're uncertain, you can become certain right now simply by calling on the name of Jesus. If you want change in your life, God will bring change in your life simply by calling on the name of Jesus. Do not let the powers of darkness stand another day between you and all the good things that God has for you. Jesus said, if you being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give you the Holy Ghost? How much more shall your Father give you the kingdom? If you're not certain that you're in Christ Jesus and Christ Jesus in you, then let it be changed tonight. Leave here tonight. Or if you're watching by YouTube, leave the place that you're sitting right now and go and live the rest of your life in a heavenly realm where God's in you and you're in Him, where Christ Jesus is in you and you in Him. If there's anyone who wants prayer so that you can be certain about your walk with God, if there's anybody who needs prayer because you've got condemnation and doubt constantly overwhelming you, and you come to recognize it's nothing but a tormenting demon spirit, and you want to be done with it once and for all, Christ Jesus, the power of God's here to heal you, to touch you, to deliver you. Just respond to Him right now. Sow your heart towards heaven by throwing your hands towards heaven. And all you have to do is say, Christ Jesus, come fill me. Come flood my soul. Come change me. Holy Ghost, overwhelm me. Take full control, and everything is different. All you do is you take the name of Jesus Christ and that which He's provided for you through His death, burial, and resurrection, and you begin now to live this day for Him and only for Him, to be taught by Him, to be led by Him. And everything that He's promised will be yours. He guarantees it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Is there anyone in here? Have we overlooked anyone? Is there a possibility that there could be somebody here right now? You're uncertain of your salvation. You're uncertain about where you stand with God. You're uncertain.
Oh yeah, because a lot of times when I was away at school, it's like, oh no, I forgot to pray over that kid with the cast. Maybe I'm gonna just
that has nothing to do with your salvation. So what that is, torment. This is harassment from the powers of darkness. And I break that yoke off of you now, in Jesus' name. Satan, you listen to me. You leave the property of God alone, in Jesus' name. Anyone here tonight, you're uncertain. The most important thing in your life is a confidence towards God. If you don't have a certainty and a confidence towards God, Satan comes along with all of his deception and lies, and he'll take you out. He'll run you down. He'll discourage you. Is there anyone tonight left in this place with any uncertainty? God's here to heal you. Remedy the problem. Run Satan off. Anyone else?
So, since I got saved, I've had this demonic thing that's come out against me. Condemnation. And then also I see where just my own thoughts from.
Father, we thank you right now for the authority that is given to us in your name. You foul spirit of hell, you tormenting lie of condemnation and guilt. You would try to claim the soul and try to claim this life. Now in Jesus' name, I command you, you leave. You quit harassing and you quit tormenting. Father, I ask you now in Jesus' name, strengthen Bill by your spirit to stand up strong in your word, to stand up strong in the things that you've spoken, and to resist anything that the enemy would try to level against the soul from this day forward in the name of Jesus. It changes. From this day forward, in the name of Jesus, the tables are turned. In Jesus' name, the tables are turned. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
One more time. And then we're gonna close. Is there anyone uncertain? We want it to come to an end in your life. Forever. Forever. Tormenting, harassing things come here. Tormenting, harassing things of the mind that makes you feel less than Christ Jesus has created you to be. Has no more ability to work against you. Now you listen to me, you spirit, hell, you enemy of all righteousness. You leave the daughter of the Lord alone. Leave the daughter of the Lord alone. Now you just be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord to stand up with great confidence and boldness from this day forward. It ain't going to be like it's been.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Amen. It's not going to be wavering, not back and forth. From this day forward, boldness and confidence.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Don't you let all that Jesus purchased for you. Be less than everything that you need. To be right with God. To be acceptable to Him. And to be everything He's purposed you to be. All in Jesus. Just what He's done. And I speak that word of life to you. And I command you to live in it. In Jesus' name. I command it. You live in it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.